Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil mursaleen. Sayyidina wa nabiyyina wa shafi'ana wa habibana wa tabibana wa maulana Muhammadin sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A subject which is very important in the life of a Muslim. Sometimes we don't make ourselves aware of this particular issue or this particular very, very serious subject that we are talking about. And what I'm talking about here is the last hour, Qiyamah. People have different terms, the Armageddon, the Great Battle, various terms are being used. But belief in the last hour is one of the fundamentals and pillars of Iman. It is a day when everyone is to get compensated or punished for one's work and has to go to heaven or hell. And we pray and hope that Allah makes us of the Jannatis. And that will depend upon our deeds, our a'mal, our way of life that we lead. This is the primary reason why every prophet in each period, in each era, to his own community, he would warn the people of the day of judgment. As for the knowledge of the time of Qiyamah, the end of the world, it has not been given to anyone, nor to any angel, nor to any prophet. إِنَّ السَّاعَةَ آتِيَةٌ أَكَادُ أُخْفِيهَا لِتُجِزَى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا تَزْغَى. Verily the hour is coming, says Allah in the Quran. My design is to keep it hidden, for every soul to receive its reward by the measure of its endeavor. In order to get one's reward according to the proportion of your a'mal. That's why Allah says, أَكَادُ أُخْفِيهَا, that I have kept it hidden. Brothers and sisters, Ya Allah, can you imagine? We have the knowledge that tomorrow is Qiyamah. Tomorrow is Qiyamah, let me guarantee you, you and I together, we will talak the world. We will talak our wives even. We'll talak everything. Because it becomes nafsa nafsi, everyone for oneself and God for everybody, as the saying goes. We will stay in Masjidul Jumuah from now right until tomorrow, if we had to know. But you see, actually having said that, please come forward, my dear brothers, before Qiyamah can Allah talk. Please pull this up. It is important, why? Because Allah has put within our hearts the hope, the rujur, that no, you know, tomorrow we're going to still be alive. 10 years time, no, 50 years time, we will still be alive. We will still do our things. Even a man who is 100 years old will have this hope in him. No, I will live another 20 years. This is what the hope that Allah has put in us. That's why Allah says, I have kept hidden the signs of the hour. And Allah mentions in another verse, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ. Verily with Allah is the knowledge of the hour. وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثَ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ. He sends down the rain and knows that which is in the wombs. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا. No person knows, says Allah, what he will earn tomorrow. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ مَوْتٍ. And no person knows in what land he will pass away. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. And Allah is the knower and all aware of all things. You know, in the hadith Jibreel alayhi salam, which I have been giving a couple of weeks ago, where Jibreel alayhi salam comes in the form of a man, and he asks Nabi alayhi salam various questions. أخبرني عن الإسلام, أخبرني عن الإيمان, أخبرني عن الإحسان. And each time the Prophet alayhi salam answers, he says, Saddaqt, I accept. And the Sahaba al-Kiram was so amazed at that type of response and answer. Then the person, the Jibreel alayhi salam, asked, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ السَّاعَةِ. Inform me about the hour. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, قال alayhi salam, مَا الْمَسْؤُولُ عَنْهَا بِأَعْلَمْ مِنَ السَّائِلِ. The one that is being asked about it knows just as much as the one that is asking. Even the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam does not know. However, certain events are going to take place. And in this hadith, Jibreel asks, alayhi salam asks the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then give us the signs, give us clues, which Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam gave. And we'll try to endeavor, inshallah, to speak a little bit about it, to make us aware. And he says, these are the events of Qiyamah that will take place, and these are the incidences that will take place. Our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would lecture to his companions whole day about this very serious event. Though only Allah knows when the last hour will come, He has given us the clues. Let's take an example. It's been reported, and these are hadith, and these are Quran, which I share with you. Abdullah bin Mas'ud has reported that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the world will not pass. It will not pass away until a man will come to rule over the Arabs of my family and will have my name, the same as mine. And of course, here Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is alluding to Imam Mahdi alayhi salam. And the signs that we are talking about is divided into minor signs and to major signs. And it's in no particular order that I'm sharing these few signs with you. When we speak about the minor signs, here we speak about the coming of the last Prophet, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is one of the signs. That sign has happened, has taken place. One of the other signs that will take place is that the slaves will become the master. In former centuries we have found, especially in Arabia, that slavery was rampant, and eventually Islam came to show that even if you have slaves, how you must treat the slaves. But it would be better for you to emancipate the slaves, to free the slaves. And then obviously that, the freeing of the slaves, at times you will find that the slaves have now become the master. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also says that the shepherds will compete in the construction of tall buildings. And a good example of this are the modern ex-nomads, which are the ex-shepherds in Saudi Arabia. You will find massive buildings are being put up all over the country, and especially, of course, the Haram as well. This is one of the signs of Akhir al-Zaman. Another one is the knowledge of Islam will be taken away, and you will find ignorance, juhala, jahil, will increase. And this removal of knowledge will be because of our pious and elderly scholars that have passed away, and you do not find the caliber of scholars replacing them. Because what is happening, and especially in the first world countries, in the Western world, whom we also classify, to become an alim, to become a scholar, is more frowned upon. It's not looked upon so much, so nicely, than to have a worldly degree and so forth and so forth. Of course, it's fard al-kifaya to become a lawyer. It's fard al-kifaya to be that we have doctors, that we have dentists, we have all the professional staff in our community. It's fard al-kifaya. If we do not have Allah in His infinite mercy, will keep us. Fard al-kifaya is the same as for the salat al-janazah. A certain group of people must discharge of washing kafan and dafan and putting the mayat away. That's called fard al-kifaya. Certain amount of people must do the job. So don't let me come over as saying that don't become doctors, don't become lawyers, don't become this. No. We are finding the signs of akhir al-zaman that people will frown upon the ulama nowadays and not show the respect and the honor and the dignity to them. And this is quite rampant as well. Another sign is drinking and zina taking place. It will be on the increase, says Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. And we're finding that has entered into our own communities. We're drinking and zina, which was something foreign to our culture, and we're finding it rampant. Go to our various social welfare organizations and we can talk about it. Another sign will be the population of men will decrease and the women increase till 50 women shall be for every man. SubhanAllah. Can you imagine the social disorder and the corruption that will take place? It's already taking place. Despite if every man marries 4 women, we won't solve that problem. Actually, if a man marries 1 woman, it's already a big problem. People don't want to marry even a woman anymore, they want to marry a man. And the woman wants to marry a woman. Signs of akhir zaman we are tending to find. 30 people will claim to be prophets and then followed by Dajjal, the Antichrist. And we'll discuss a bit of that as we go on. There will also be an abundance of wealth to such a degree that we will not find recipients to give our zakat to. Killing will be increased, says the Nabi alayhi salam. Murder, it becomes rampant. And you're finding that. And also, you will find time will be shortened so that a year will be like a month will be like a day will be like an hour. And this perception, this dwindling of time seems to be very apparent also in the first world countries. Actually, I'm finding that personally. As if 24 hours in our lives is not enough, we haven't got enough hours left. And that's to our detriment, really. We have to manage time, we have to apportion time. But we are finding it's not happening. We are finding, as if there's no time to do this. Why is time going away so quickly? Can't we step off this world? Another sign of the times will be 2 great countries will fight and kill each other, and both claiming the same thing. I have won, no, I have won, and they want the same ideals. We will also find the earthquakes will increase in number. And we're finding that so much in various parts of the countries. So many earthquakes are taking place. Another sign will be, not last but not least, a person will go past a qabr. And he will wish out of despair, out of hopelessness, to trade places with the Qabr, subhanAllah. One of the major signs that I want to touch upon is a Dajjal will be coming. Dajjal will be coming, and he will claim to be God, holding both heaven and hell, and his first purpose is to deceive the unbelievers will follow him. Deception will be huge. And the Nabi al-Islam describes it. He is short, red-faced, blind in the right eye, and his hair which sticks up. Sometimes I think of our youngsters. That gel, you know, that gel, you know. It's been said he will go around the world, but he will be unable to enter into Makkah or Madinatul Munawwarah. He will remain on this earth for 40 days, of which the first day, says Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, will be as long as a year, the second day as long as a month, the third as a week, and the rest will be normal in length. And as you say, he will try to gain entry into the two holy cities, but the malaikats will be guarding the two holy cities and will bond him. He will flee from there to Syria, where he will meet resistance from the forces of Imam Mahdi alayhi salam, the leader of the Muslims, and there shall a battle take place between good and evil. The emergence of Dajjal is the most important sign, as his trial and fitna will be the biggest ever seen on this dunya. And those who got iman, even their iman will be shaken. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, between the creation of the Prophet Adam alayhi salam and the coming of the last hour, there will arise no matter more serious than Dajjal. The Dajjal will appear once the Muslim army has conquered Constantinople and reached Syria. Emerging from the east, moving from the city to city, he will perform unusual feats and will cause fitna wherever he goes. And before we move to his trials and tribulations and his deceptions and trickery and things like that, we need to ask a few questions here. Is he alive? What are the signs that will precede him? How will we recognize him? And here is a story which is a hadith. It is a story of Sayyidina Tamim Dari radiallahu anhu, where he answers these kind of questions. And it's been reported by Fatima bint Qais radiallahu anhu that she says that I heard the Muaddin calling the Adhan for the congregational prayer, and I went to the masjid and prayed with Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he finished his prayer, Nabi alayhi salam sat on the pulpit, smiling, and he orders, let every man in his seat remain seated. And he then asks alayhi salam, do you know why I call you? And they replied, Wallahi wa Rasul, only he knows. The Prophet said, I have called you not together for hope or for fear, but I have called you because Tamim Ad-Dari, who was a Christian, embraced Islam, and he has narrated a story to me which agreed with the account I had given to you about Dajjal. And Nabi Islam goes further by saying, he informed me that they were a party of 30 people from Nakhm and Jozem. They were on a boat, and for 30 days, for a month, the waves were crushing them about, moving, they had no control. And eventually they landed upon an island. Now there's a lot have been written about this island. Some people say Britain, some people say various other, but we will leave that at this stage. They said they sat beside this small boat, and a beast with coarse hair met them. And Tamim Al-Dari and the Sahaba is explaining, you had so much hair that they could not even recognize the front from his back, as they described. And they asked, who are you? He said, I'm a spy. And this man says, go to the man in the monastery. He is eager to receive your information. Tamim Dari says, radiallahu anhu, when he named the name of this man, they ran away because they thought it was Shaitan. But eventually they ran away to the monastery. And they say they found a big-bodied man whom we had never seen before. He was firmly tied up, his hands tied to his neck, He's placed between his knees and joints tied with iron chains. And we asked him, who are you? And he replied, you have the power to get in my information. Firstly, inform me about yourselves. And they replied, we are from Arabia. We went on a sea boat, but the sea waves played us for a month, and and threw us on this island. And then we met a particular person with so much hair, and he said he's a spy, and he told us to come to this monastery. So that's why we are here. This person asks, who's in chains? Tell me about the trees of Beza. Do they bear fruit? He says, yes. And the man says, behold, soon they will not yield any fruit. And he asks the next question, inform me about Lake Tiberias. Is there water in it? He said, yes. He said, there will be no more water in it. Soon it will disappear. Inform me about the mountain of Zagara. Is there water in it? And these are the questions that's being asked all the time. And one of the questions that was asked is, inform me of the prophet of the illiterates. What does he do? He said, we had just come out of Makkah and gone to Yathrib. He said, have the Arabs fought him? He said, yes. How did he treat him? We informed him that he got the upper hand of the Arabs who opposed him, and they now obey him. And this man answers, behold, it is better for them if they obey him. As for myself, I am certainly the Antichrist. And it is near that an order will be passed for me to come out. I shall then come out and travel the world. I shall leave no village at which I shall not land within 40 nights, except Makkah and Tayyibah, which is forbidden to me. Whenever I wish to enter, one of the two Malaikat with a sword will encounter me and will stop me and prevent me from coming in. The Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as he's discussing this story, he took his staff, his asa, and he struck it on the pulpit. And he said, this is Tayyibah, meaning Madinatul Munawwara. And behold, did I not tell you? Yes, they all replied. Behold, he is in the Syrian Sea, or the Sea of Yemen. No, rather he is in an easterly direction. And he pointed towards in the easterly direction. The Al-Mahdi, alayhi salam, will come at the time of Al-Dajjal, and he will call to the true Islam, and he will be a military leader. His name will be exactly like our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His name will be Muhammad ibn Abdullah. And his father's name will match the same as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's father's name. And he will be a descendant from Fatima al-Zahra radiallahu anha. And the coming of the Mahdi is one of the signs of Qiyamah, and it is a belief of the Ahl Sunni wal Jama'ah that he is going to come. However, many people in the past have falsely claimed that I am the Imam Mahdi. And we can go through many names. One of them was Muhammad ibn Tumart, a tyrant who caused so much corruption. He even buried his own companions because they didn't believe he was the Mahdi. And this is described by the Hadith Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. There was also another one named by the name of Muhammad ibn al-Askari, who at the age of 5 disappeared and hasn't been seen for 1,000 years. And we have so many. We've had in Africa. And of late we've also had Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of the Ahmadiyya Qadiani movement, who also claimed that he was the Mahdi. We even had one recent in Manchester, in London, in Britain, who also claimed he's the Mahdi. We have to understand, my dear brothers, that's why this hadith by Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, because you must understand, these people who claim they're the Mahdi, they are sweet talkers. They talk you straight into Jannah, the way they talk, but in effect it's the other way on. Other way on. Don't you find in our community this is happening? But that's why my reason to share these few things with you. We have to understand, it must be noted, that none of the criteria and the signs which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has explained all Allah has mentioned in the Quran, fulfill any of these liars. Mirza Ghulam Ahmad died in the toilet. Would Allah allow that for his bilal? To give you an example, I want to present, I don't think we'll finish today, because we need to carry this over, but it's important, I have to speak to you on Gog and Magog, on Dhulqarnain, the Great Barrier, there's so many aspects, but I need to give it to you in a nutshell. Please read. I need to give you some of these preceding signs of the Imam Mahdi when he comes. One of the great signs of preceding Imam Mahdi is the battle in Mina. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's been reported by Amr bin Shu'ayb, reported from his grandfather, that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in the month of Dhul-Qa'dah, the tribes will fight, the Hujjaj will be looted, and there will be a battle in Mina, in which many people will be slain, and blood will flow, until it runs over to Jamaratul Aqba. Their companions, in other words, Imam Mahdi alayhi salam's companions, they will run to Hajar al-Aswad, and between Hajar al-Aswad and the Maqam Ibrahim, and they will go to Imam Mahdi, and they will pledge their allegiance in his hand to assist them and relieve them of this. This is one of the signs which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, that will precede the Mahdi. Another one will be, the Euphrates will disclose a mountain of gold. Abu Hurairah reports that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the hour shall not come until the Euphrates will disclose the mountain of gold, which people will fight. 99 out of 100 shall be killed in the hope. Why? Because of their greed. And they will say, no, maybe I will get that gold. And this is described in Muslim, Sahih Muslim. In another narration, it's been said, when the time comes and when the Euphrates gold is being disclosed, don't go for it. Stop. Don't go for it. These are the signs. Another of the signs will be the emergence of Sufyan. This is a descendant of Abu Sufyan. And he will emerge before Imam Mahdi in Damascus. And Abu Hurairah has narrated that the Prophet ﷺ said, a man will emerge from the depth of Damascus. He will be called Sufyani. Most of those who follow him will be from the tribe of Kalb. He will kill by ripping the women and even the stomachs of the women. And he will even kill the children. Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes further by saying, a man from my family will appear in the haram. The news of his advent will reach Sufyani, and he will send his army, in other words, Imam Mahdi. And Imam Mahdi will encounter him, and he will defeat him. And many of these signs we will talk about, inshallah. I need to highlight today, especially the one aspect. Because one of the hadith which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talks about is Suratul Kahf, which we'll discuss inshallah next week. The reason why we recite Suratul Kahf as a sunnah on the day of Friday, we understand that because Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that, so doctor ya Rasulullah, we accept. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever recites the first 10 verses of Surah Kahf will be saved from Dajjal. From Alhamdulillah الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا. From there till إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف فقالوا ربنا. Subhanallah, when those youth ran away into the cave, إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف, those who fled from the cave and they will make dua. قالوا ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. Oh Allah, bestow upon us your mercy from yourself and facilitate us our affairs in the right way. Ameen, ya Rabbal Alameen. And this, inshallah, if Allah wills, we will speak next week about it, inshallah. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.